It was in South Carolina. Carmen Bowman said I should learn about this thing called the Eden Alternative, and Donna Gross. And was it South Carolina? Would have been, what year would that have been? So 2002. I set up the way we used to set up a booth. Our company is all about engagement technology and blah, blah, blah. And so anyway, I'd set up a booth with like wires everywhere, and it was horrible and nothing really worked right. And I had no idea what anything was about with the Eden Alternative, and I would say all the wrong, I still kind of do, say some of the wrong words and terminology. But this woman I had never met before, and I had no context of, she sat down and talked to me for about 30 minutes about what this whole thing was all about. And I had no idea who you were. I had no idea the whole affiliation with Bill. But I just felt such warmth, as opposed to with Perna now, it's how do you crank up your sponsorship level? So I've kind of gone full circle on this whole thing. But it was so meaningful, Jude. And then through the years, getting to know Haley and Hannah, going out to your farm, and I think now is the good picture time, Karen, so you kind of have the whole evolution is so many years, like 2 or 3 years later, getting to know Nancy. And Nancy, it was such a meaningful thing for me, is that Nancy invited me to speak in Australia with my two boys. And that is, so that's what? That's 2006. And Nathan, the little guy on the right, who a lot of you know, I'm flying from here to D.C. To his graduation from American University. And so this whole, this whole gig as a company, but especially the Eden world, it's been, you've welcomed, Jude, Bill, Nancy, Chris, you guys have welcomed what we do with such open arms, and it's been so meaningful for us. And we just, it's like a month ago, had a press release going out that we just had it's such a big deal to me, but we had our 2000th community that has our engagement technology. That's a big deal. And in the political, all the political crap that we all are dealing with right now, I love this country. I mean, to have an idea in 1998 of there's got to be a better way to get, those of you who know me, I don't know anything about aging or anything about senior living or anything about adaptive technology. But a friend of mine, Leslie Sweeney, had the idea of let's donate some computers. And at that time, I had money and no time, and she had time and no money. And so we were a perfect partnership. And so anyway, we just donated computers. And it was just like, man, these people have so much to give, and they're such cool people. And why should just us be, all of us be able to take advantage of this technology thing when they have a thirst to stay connected just as much as we do? And so it has been, the cliche of a labor of love. But I just, I don't think there's not too many places in the world that you can have an idea, be able to just run with it and turn it into a successful, profitable company. And so, I mean, I love this country. And it's frustrating, all the stuff that gets thrown back and forth. So anyway, very, very cool stuff. And thank you, Chris, for this. One thing I want to say is tonight is going to be, I've got the $500 somehow here, but we've got Eden's Got Talent. We have I loved the email that you wrote, Laura, about it has been kind of an interesting journey. You have no idea what goes on year to year. So it's, what is it? Karen, 7:30 to 10:30? Okay, so it's the Eden's Got Talent part's going to be about an hour and 15 minutes. We have 6 people signed up. We want 6 more. And then after, it's going to turn into a rather interesting musical walkthrough history. So if you are interested in an interesting evening that's free, come in and watch that. The one thing I do want to say, I have one request, which you can either be, it'd be great to do it right now. I'm looking for, and I'm thinking of like Angie to talk about your signature crowd. You'd be able to pull somebody for this, but I'm trying to find one woman and one man who are adventurous, because we have a little bit of a challenge for you during the Eden's Got Talent is there, and you'll win money at the end of this experience if you win. If you're one of the two, it's two people. It's not a big group, but it's going to be very unique what we ask you to do. So, anybody want to, just with that as a prelude, does anybody want to volunteer? Okay, all right. What's your name?
Steve.
We got the male over here. And Evie. Oh my God, that is perfect. Okay, all right. Well, do you want me to tell you what it is now since I got the people? Okay, what you're going to be challenged to do. No, I'm not going to tell you. I'll say what it is at the start of Eden's Got Talent, and then you have an hour and 15 minutes to do it. And it doesn't involve Perna's room. Doesn't matter. Now, what you're doing is totally separately. So with that, it is my pleasure to open up day two of the extravaganza. And if you want to see what we're doing, come to the session I'm doing with Nancy or with Al Power, 2, 3, something like that. All right. Thank you. Bye.
Hello? Okay, it's on. And if you want to sign up for the talent show, you can sign up at the bookstore or in the... or in the IN2L booth. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. We are so honored to be presenting the awards this morning amongst all of this greatness in this room and this specialness and the love. It's just an honor for us. I'm Suzette Molina, and this is my co-host, Aaron Blackburn, from the Eden Home Office, and we have a translator up here with us so we don't mess up too bad on the names. We're going to get started. We have so many worthy nominees, and the committee asked that we let you know the struggle was real. They had a really, really hard time. They lost sleep over decisions, and you'll see how that plays out later. But if you hear your name today as a nominee or as a winner, please stand so that we can honor you. If you are a winner, we would ask you come up here and receive your award from Chris Perna and have your picture taken. Okay, let's get started with the 2016 International Eden Elder Award.
So, good morning, everyone. The International Eden Elder Award recognizes the extraordinary efforts of an elder care partner in applying the Eden Alternative Philosophy to creating a life worth living.
And the nominees are Will Bernthal, Ruth Iverson, Lucy Kennedy, and Alice Lute. And we have a tie. And the winners are Lucy Kennedy and Alice Lute.
When Lucy Kennedy became Elder Council President of Signature Healthcare of North Florida, she had no idea what an agent of change she was about to become. She worked with Senator Gates to increase the Medicaid allowance for elders living in nursing homes. And so, what started as a $35 a month allowance, thanks to Lucy, is now a $105 allowance. Yeah. And according to Lucy, Lucy took on the voice of those around her. She did it not for herself, but for everybody else. And she fought for a cause she believed in, and she won. Thank you, Lucy.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Alice Lute is an amazing woman who's always led a life of service. She started her service as a Catholic nun and a former elementary educator, and she's now serving Traceway Manor by facilitating activities, wide range. She leads a theatrical group, she leads painting classes, she coordinates educational programs. In her spare time, Alice has been known to cook for peers who might not be feeling well. She writes for the newspaper at Traceway, and she's currently fundraising to enhance the Eden Garden there. I don't know how you find time to do it all. So we are more than honored to present your 2016 International Eden Elders. Our next award is the International Eden Employee Care Partner Award. This award recognizes the extraordinary efforts of an employee care partner in applying the Eden Alternative philosophy to creating a life worth living.
And the nominees are Marlon Cruz, Nympha Daniel, Crystal Marroquin, Lily Stark, Philip Ramey, Caroline Teesland, Sarah Walker, and Teresa Wertheim. We have a tie. And the winners are Lily Stark and Philip Ramey.
Lily couldn't join us today, but we will be accepting the award on her behalf and making sure that she gets that. Lily Stark has been an Eden Champion Activity Coordinator of 10 years standing. Immediately after her own Eden Associate training, she began empowering residents of Murray House to be involved in all of the decisions made. Amidst a challenging transition where four homes were funneled down into just one, it was Lily who provided unrelenting support to the team and who made sure that the Eden Alternative philosophy still survives at Murray House through all of the change. She promotes Eden Alternative to everyone she comes in contact with, and in the words of the Murray House manager, Lily is a marvel. Philip Ramey is the chaplain at Riverview Healthcare Center, where I hear he creates an atmosphere of joy and spontaneity on a daily basis. He's organized fishing trips. He created a movie theater in the home. He's recently begun coaching care partners to become healthier, to create an entire atmosphere of wellness. Last year, Philip was diagnosed with cancer. In the face of adversity, he turned to the elders. He asked them to shave his head. And so, yes, they had a head shaving party. And sharing this intimate moment truly shows the relationship that Philip has with the elders. They need him, they want to care for him, and he needs them as well. So, Lily and Philip, our 2016 International Eden Employees this year. Next is our International Eden Family Member Award, and this recognizes the extraordinary efforts of a family member care partner in applying the philosophy to creating a life worth living.
And the winner is
Jakob Karason.
She's going to accept the award for him.
Okay. And Reinveig will be accepting the award. Forgive my pronunciation. I can't say it quite like she did, but I'm going to go with Jakob. Jakob Karason is known for bringing joy and happiness to the elders of the nursing home where his wife resides in Iceland. Jacob makes steadfast visits. He's often bringing baked goods. He's working as a volunteer. But what stood out about him the most is that he invites elders to his own home so that he can personally cook for them recipes that they love and that they miss. So we're glad to present Jacob Carrison as our Eden family member for this year. Mm. Up next is the Nancy Fox Leadership Award. This award recognizes an individual who embodies leadership in thought, word, and deed through the Eden Alternative philosophy.
And the nominees are Carol Burt, Alethea DeVillers, Beverly Heasley, Angie McAllister, Connie Miller, Heather Reynolds,
Helga Erlingsdóttir, Þóra Sif Sigurðardóttir,
and Robert Walker. And the winner is Angie McAllister.
Nine years ago, Angie McAllister became the Quality of Life Director for Pickett Care and Rehabilitation. She is now the Director of Quality of Life and Culture Change for all of Signature Healthcare. Angie started this venture by bringing a bowling team, a swim club, and helicopter rides to Pickett Care and Rehab. Since then, she has created Camp Signature, an intergenerational program allowing stakeholders to bring their children to work. She's gotten an entire company to sponsor elder vacations so they can go parasailing, they can attend a Major League Baseball game, whatever their heart desires. And she has led the charge to fundraise for nursing homes in need in South Africa. Thanks to Angie's dedication, 37 Signature homes are now Eden registered homes. We're moving on to our Master Gardener Award. This recognizes the unwavering commitment of a care community or community-based service to bring the Eden Alternative principles to life in daily practice.
And the nominees are Calhoun County Medical Care Facility, Connecting Care, Mountain City Care and Rehabilitation, Riverview Healthcare Center,
Seniorenzentrum Krefeld,
and Signature Healthcare of Erin. And the winner is Mountain City Care and Rehabilitation in Mountain City, Tennessee. Accepting the award is Sherry Osborne and Diana Branch.
In 2013, Mountain City Care and Rehabilitation began implementing the neighborhood model in their community. Just 2 years later, they blazed the trail to create a holistic caregiver model in which they had to cross-train their staff and completely revamp their daily schedule. All of the effort was worth it because today, if you were to visit Mountain City Care, you would find that their leadership team is present in the community on a daily basis. You would find neighborhood mentors who are clearly empowered. And most importantly, you would see elders who are at the center of their own care. Thank you. Up next is the Seedling Award. The Seedling Award recognizes a care community or home and community-based service new to the Eden Alternative Journey that has demonstrated a level of commitment and progressiveness that challenges others to grow.
And the nominees are Liberty Care and Rehabilitation, Oakview Care and Rehabilitation Center, Points West Living Lloydminster, Points West Living Wainwright Community, Ravidan Home and Village, and this last one from Switzerland. I don't want to damage it. And we have another tie. Did I mention the struggle that this committee had deciding? The winners are Points West Living Lloydminster and Points West Living Wainwright Community.
Points West Living Lloydminster joined the Eden Registry in 2015. Here, learning circles are a familiar sight. Discussions constantly revolve around alleviating the three plagues, and elders regularly assist with meal preparation and maintenance of the garden. The first consideration for any decision made at Points West Living Lloydminster has always been, does it provide choice? And is this in the best interest of our residents? Points West Living Wainwright established an Eden committee in 2013. Monthly elder meetings and a meaningful mealtimes education program highlight that community's Eden spirit. They have regular social events, a wide variety of animal visitors and companions, I think even including horses and frogs and who knows what else. They also have active partnerships with over 20 community organizations. So it's no surprise that the turnover is low and the soil is warm at Points West Living Wainwright. Our final award today is the Eden Champion Award. And this award recognizes the efforts of an individual who champions the ongoing growth of the Eden Alternative philosophy, bringing it to life for those closest to them and others around the world.
And the nominees are Candace Avila, Karen Boyer, Brett Brown,
Guðbjörg Guðmundsdóttir, og Hrefna Brynja Gísladóttir,
Batsheva Katz, Kit Leeson Peterson, Angie McAllister, Carolyn Mickey Rule, Shannon Pugh, Davina Rawiri, and Ann Von Dam. We have a three-way tie. And the winners are Batsheva Katz, Kit Leeson Peterson, and Ann Von Dam. Come on up.
Batsheva Katz has been the impetus behind Windsor Healthcare Community's culture change journey beginning in 2009. She had to convince her family to start that journey, by the way, which was no easy feat. Windsor Healthcare is a family-owned business in New Jersey with 9 homes serving approximately 1,600 elders. Their journey began with Eden Associate trainings for 2 of the homes, and now, thanks to Batsheva, all 9 homes have participated in Eden training. Almost 200 care partners are Eden associates, and 4 of the homes have joined the registry. It's without doubt that Windsor Healthcare and the Eden tribe at large are the beneficiaries of Batsheva's vision, commitment, and heart. Kit Lusane Paterson began her path as a nurse and in 2013 became an Eden mentor in Denmark. Kit is the strategic leader for 9 nursing homes and 7 homes that support the needs of those that live with different physical, psychological, and cognitive abilities. Kit was one of the first to include residents and family members in the employment process of new leaders. She has fought to earn the support of local politicians in order to grow the Eden alternative in her area. 6 of the homes that Kit oversees are on the registry, and the other 3 are already on their way to joining. Thanks to Kit, organizations are thriving, and life has been made worth living for so many. Anne Van Dam embodies the Eden spirit at Avendrust Home in Australia. There, care plans are written in the first person. There's monthly barbecues, visits from children and pets are a given. But Anne has taken Eden beyond the walls of Avendrust as well. She's fostered ongoing consultation with nearby schools. She facilitates an extensive program for Dutch nursing student placement. And she even shares Eden ideas with the shop owners next door, because that's where families and residents go to shop. To know Anne is to know a true Eden champion.
Thank you so much. And thank you, all of you, for attending our conference and for being a part of this journey to make life worth living. We could not do it without the efforts of every single one of you that are here today and many that could not make it with us today. Would you all please rise and give yourselves a big round of applause, because together we are all champions. Now we're going to have the international panel.
Do you want the mic?
Drop the mic. Don't drop the mic. Don't do an Obama. Don't drop the mic. Okay. I have to say, that's a hard act to follow. And on behalf of the international regional coordinators, we salute all of you, because you are doing amazing work. And we have the privilege of continuing to share stories with all of you from around the globe. This is our 3rd conference where we get to take the stage. It's fabulous. It's wonderful. And on behalf of our friends and colleagues who aren't here, but they are with us in spirit, and I'm going to name them. Just got to get the clicker thing sorted. Oh, here we go. This photo was taken in Dusseldorf in 2015, some of us went, some of us didn't, and some of those people who went to Dusseldorf are here for the first time, and they're sitting behind me on the stage. But our friends and colleagues from around the globe who aren't with us, because I know this is being taped and I'll get killed if I don't mention their names, we have Rain Strobel, who was with us last time from Eden, South Africa. We have Magda Pienaar, June Burgess, and Paul Bailey from Eden, UK and Ireland. And unfortunately, they were going to be here, but sadly had to bail last week due to ill health. And we believe June is on the road to recovery, so that's fantastic. So some of us have to step in. We have the delightful Diana Mellis, who is Eden, Netherlands. We have Sylvia Nachue. I said that correctly, they'll correct me later. Sylvia is Switzerland, yes. We have Renata Wopplinger, who is also an Eden coordinator. She's based in Vienna. And we have our fabulous friend, Ursa Persmore. I didn't say that right, I know, but anyway. And behind me, we have all these other fabulous people who you'll get to meet over time. So let's get started. Why are we here? When we thought about what we do as leaders, every single person that's on this stage are leaders in their own right. We are coordinators of a region. And in my wisdom, I'm the newest coordinator for Eden Asia, Southeast. I know, it's pretty big. And we thought, what would be our topic? And we thought Principle 10 is absolutely critical in what we do. And if we think about wise leaders, in the roles that we play, we are leaders. We also get to meet and work with some amazing people around the globe. And in their own rights, they are leaders. And they provide wise leadership to us, and we learn from them. One of the things that's universally a challenge is what happens when the leader leaves a home. And we know that unless the Eden alternative is embedded in the culture of that home or that community, when the leader leaves, so does the Eden alternative. And that's heartbreaking. It's heartbreaking for the staff. It's heartbreaking for the elders most of all, because they've been shown a way that's absolutely fantastic and powerful, and it gets ripped away and destroyed. So we thought we would look at what are the elements of leadership. And I know there's lots of words that you could all go, but what about? And trust me, we had about 40 of them, and then some. And we decided we would synthesize those down to six. And in the spirit of storytelling, we thought we would share some more stories. So today we have with us Silke, who is from Germany, and she's our newest member, which is fantastic. Paul was going to be here. I'm going to be speaking for him, so I don't have quite the same deep voice. We have Cheryl George, we have Ranvi, we have Karen, and then there's obviously me. And we thought we would start with a saying from our founder, friend, fantastic mentor man, Dr. Bill Thomas. And he says that really the stories are the diamonds of culture. And nowadays, older people are taught not to tell their stories. And this is our loss, not theirs. So each of us are going to be talking about an elder story, and it's not necessarily about older people. And we're going to start with our words around leadership. And as you can see, there's a lot of them. There's so many. And every single one of you in this room has leadership potential, or you are leaders in your own right. And you exhibit many of these characteristics. So we're going to start with inspirational. And I'm going to hand this over to... Who's got inspiration? Silke.
Okay. My words is inspiration. As human beings, we are able to see, hear, and feel. Everyone has their own perception channels which we follow. Everyone has their own inspiration. Inspiration triggers are the people we meet and situations we experience. We have to learn to be more mindful of this inspiration again and challenge ourselves to follow and express it. Memories and wonderful stories, ideas, and actions brought to life by our creativity and actually happen. To this end, I have brought a short story for you. During an Aiden training, Andrea said, actually, we fulfill a lot of small wishes of our older people and employers. However, those who aren't brave enough to express their wish will never get the chance of fulfillment. I asked him if he could try to change the situation. He replied, well, I don't know, but June and Paul spoke about a certain wishing tree on the networking days in Düsseldorf. Still, he doubted. I asked him what stopped him also creating a wishing tree. He answered, do you think this could work? I replied, there is always a way if you are ready to look for it. The following morning, during the training, he told other participants about his idea of the wishing tree. They responded enthusiastically and wanted to be part of the team, which would fulfill wishes. A work group was set up, and immediately they worked intensively on the concept of the wishing tree, and when they were unsure about how to move on, they asked for my support. Following, they presented their idea to the management team and their colleagues, which led to even more employees promising their support. The main presentation happened during the Spring Festival, with the result of a colorful tree full of wishes. Ms. Poncela's wish, Andrea's first experience with the wishing tree. It was April the 4th. Right after the Spring Festival, on which I usually presented the wishing tree and its purpose had ended. I was standing at the entrance of the retirement home when Ms. Poncela came up to me and looked at me misty-eyed. You are the one with the wishes? Yes, Ms. Poncela, I am. I also have a wish. What wish do you have? Just one last time, I want to go to the countryside with my sisters. Can you do this? It was speechless. There was a lady about a hair shorter than I am, in front of me, looking up to me in total excitement. In her face, I could recognize how torn she was between hope, joy, and sadness. She looked at me with teary eyes, asking me to fulfill just this one wish. She downright begged for it and just stood there, knowing how to deal with this situation. Since I did not expect such a strong reaction. It was just a moment, but I felt like we were standing there for several minutes, just looking into each other's eyes. It was torn between what I wanted to do and what I was actually able to do. I didn't want to disappoint Ms. Poncela in already promising the realization of her wish, but at the same time, I knew I couldn't even do it since I didn't know all the facts. What if the sisters weren't mobile anymore? What if one of the sisters wasn't living close? After I had gathered myself, I told Ms. Poncela that I would try to fulfill this wish, but could not promise anything. I still asked her to put the wish up on the tree and wait patiently. The mayor promised it wanting to take care of the matter was enough to put a smile to the resident's face. But to me, the just experienced situation wasn't done at all, since it still preoccupied me to whole night as well as the next day as soon as I woke up. Now it is Monday, April the 18th, and I start to make the wishes, which the residents have put up the tree come true. Also, I took care of Ms. Poncela's dream. I called her nice, who told me that the both sisters would be able to participate in a trip to the countryside. Apart from that, she would also be part of the wishes trip to the countryside. Conclusion, I see my task in giving people space and inspiration to live their ideas and their creativity. They encourage them to be open towards change or even to be brave enough to create something now, anew. The energy with organized from this behavior helps people to move and be inspirational themselves and creating something which connects all of us. When the wind of change blows, some build walls and others build windmills. We build windmills. Thank you.
Okay, this is for June and Paul, and I have the story written, so you'll have to bear with me while I do this, because these two people are fabulous and they've made such a difference in UK and Ireland. And that's June on the right and Paul on the left, and hello from us to you. And what is really exciting, and unfortunately Lily can't be here, Lily Stark, who won the award earlier, this is her home that we're going to talk about, Murray House. And Murray House is Principle 8 in action. And we didn't quite plan it, this is the word, to match the principle, but it's just evolved as we planned our presentation. So Murray House is the last of four homes that were managed by the Royal Borough of Kingston. One was closed in 2012 and another in 2015. And it was transferred to a not-for-profit organisation. Murray House has been waiting for its final notice for the last 2 years. And this has certainly added no certainty beyond the next few months. They're sort of in that limbo land. Are we open? Are we closed? Are we open? Are we closed? So, Murray House began the Eden journey in 2007 and in 2010 became the first home to be included on the Eden Alternative UK Register of Homes. Most of you don't necessarily know, but we have more than 200 homes around the globe that are on the Eden Registry. So they are homes that are committed to the philosophy of care and are committed to changing the lives of elders. And certainly in the UK, this is one home that is doing amazing things. So they have been enthusiastic and innovative throughout their journey, and particularly through the turmoil of the last few years. And any of you who've ever been taken over by another organisation, hopefully they've got the same principles and values, but if they don't, it can really be quite devastating. In this case, they're still wondering whether they're going to exist. When we visited in 2012, i.e. June and Paul, they were in the middle of managing the closure of the first home and the transfer of the remaining residents into Murray House. This was brilliantly planned and executed, with the residents of the closing home regularly spending time with the residents at Murray House. So we're thinking about transition. How do we make that easier for other people? We were unable to find a resident with any anxiety about the move, and most appeared to be looking forward to it. On the other side of the coin, the staff had to cope with continual uncertainty about their jobs and the future of the home. What was impressive was that this had little impact on the residents' experience. In November 2015, we received an email from the manager asking for revalidation. So June and Paul go back and they review and see how everyone's going and have they strengthened, they built on, what's really happening. And they decided that even though they were still operating in this no man's land, that they really wanted to have that revalidation visit and to really maintain their registration. So in January this year, June and Paul went back. In 2016, Murray House has two floors of residence, 18 permanent residents, including a few who transferred from the closed home, have their rooms on the first floor. And on the ground floor, it's a floating population of assessment residents. And they're there, they're short-term residents. So they come in, they might have a bit of rehabilitation and some support that just keeps them going. And then they go back out to the community sometimes. And these people may be a resident for as little as 24 hours or in a few cases for up to 3 months, but no longer. And the situation is complicated by the reality that a lot of the assessment group arrive angry. And you would see that when you get new residents moving into care and they don't know why they're there and it's not their decision. And yep, they've got a right to be angry. Murray has made Principle 8 the cornerstone of its implementation. The residents have been involved in many aspects of the management of the home and in staff selection from early on in their implementation. So the residents were a part of the selection panel for the new staff that work at Murray House. And for some, for those of you new to the Eden journey, you're thinking, oh my Lord, but it's possible and it's empowering and it's amazing. In 2016, you have a group of permanent residents who are involved in everything and expect to be so. It would have been easy to operate as two services rather than one. However, this is not what happened. The challenge for staff and residents was to find a way to treat everyone the same. The solution was to involve the long-term residents in the care and support of new temporary residents. They took all their new residents, ensuring that they
can find their way about, be involved in things that are happening and blurring the distinction between the two groups. In effect, what they are doing is what they have always done by recognising that this group is a very different situation to their own. A relative we spoke to during their visit said that her mother was leaving Murray at the end of the month and that although both were looking forward to her coming home, the daughter in particular was very conscious that she could not provide anything like the social environment that her mother was enjoying at Murray, an environment that has been created by the residents as much as by the staff. So the story that Paul wanted us to share with you today is around a gentleman who we'll call Frank. And Frank is profoundly deaf and he was admitted to Murray late one afternoon. He arrived with his own carer and agency employee, not unusual for the first few days for these residents. And while she settled Frank into his room, she became aware that his clothes were filthy and that they needed laundering, and she gathered them up and took them to the laundry. This made Frank really angry. And from his point of view, the council had dumped him in this home and stolen his clothes. Have you seen that happen before? They've taken my purse, they've taken my money, and they've taken my clothes. I can't leave here. It's not true, but it's okay. You can understand why it happens. She made the point that the clothes did not get that dirty in the day and that another day while Frank settled in would have made no difference. Sorry, let me just say. So a Murray House carer took the agency carer to one side and explained what had happened and the way that Murray managed these situations. The carer made the point that the clothes did not get that dirty in a day and that another day while Frank settled in would have made no difference, i.e. he could have kept his clothes as they were. Why would you take them away? You're stripping away his privacy and dignity and who he is. Over the next couple of days, Frank refused to leave his room. He did not watch the television that was available and basically just sat, refusing attempts by staff and other residents to involve him in things that were happening. Eventually, Josie, the manager, sat down with him to find out what he needed to make him at least happier than he was. So we're now seeing the domains of well-being implemented on an individual basis. After a considerable period, she discovered that he wanted his own television that had built-in subtitles. The one in the lounge did not have this facility, and the other thing he wanted was his jacket. Both were in his flat. Reading his notes, Josie discovered that Frank lived in sheltered accommodation not far from Murray House. She rang the manager to see if someone could bring his television and coat to Murray. "Sorry," was the reply, "but no, we can't. I don't have a car." Josie agreed for Josie to go and to pick up the coat, in brackets as dirty as the other clothes, as well as the television. So Josie put on her coat and walked around to the flat, picked up the television and the coat and walked back to Murray. Frank gets his television with subtitles and is persuaded to allow his coat to be cleaned. Josie takes the coat to the laundry where another problem arises. The coat needs to be dry cleaned. And so would have been sent out and wouldn't be back for another 24 hours. The care partner in the laundry, who happens to read the label, says she knows a way to safely clean the jacket with the available equipment that she has, which she does, and the clean coat is returned to Frank on the day, so he's maintaining that connection. Paul and June write, "We like this story as it illustrates perfectly what can be achieved if staff understand that their role is to support residents and not be constrained by their job description. It is not the role of the carer to train or coach agency staff. It's not the role of the manager to fetch a television and coat from a temporary residence flat. And it's not the role of the domestic to advise the laundry. The fact that everyone did what they needed to do meant that Frank is settled, if not happy. He's not as angry as he was. Murray House still has no idea whether they will be operating at Christmas time this year. However, the success that they have had in their new role and the part that the Eden Alternative Philosophy has had in this achievement has meant that they are becoming increasingly hard to replace." Oh, I'm still on. Okay. Word number three, creative. Now, at the last conference, I had the privilege of sharing a story about Elizabeth Knox Home and Hospital in Auckland and their amazing connection with community through volunteers. And I'm not going to steal Jill's thunder because Jill is here to do a presentation at 11 o'clock, which I really encourage you all to go and attend. But in 2012, I shared with you, and 2014, I shared with you what they were doing with their volunteer group. And in 2012, Knox had approximately 20 volunteers. And in 2014, that number had grown to around 120 volunteers. This year, they now have 700 volunteers who visit and spend time and are part of the fabric of Knox every month. I can't even get my head around the numbers, let alone the possibilities. So this is an amazing home and really what is possible. And if we think about, you know, part of the definition of creative, it's when change unleashes people's creative energy. And that's the challenge. Volunteers, we need to shift the way that we see volunteers because they are not an alternative workforce. They're not a replacement for your current care partners. They are there to support and enhance and to really add another layer. And as Jill described them to me, they've become known as the polyfiller in the organisation. So they fill the gaps of the things that might happen. Quite like that, polyfiller. It's all gorgeous. So the residents are influencing the community and the volunteers are part of that fabric. It's quite homogenous. You cannot determine who's a volunteer, who the care partners are, or who the residents are, which is a fantastic way to say this is community. And one of the things that Knox is doing is actually then moving outwards, taking the elders out into the community and trying to influence what's happening out there. The key elements for Knox is it's a mixture of young people, old people, new migrants to New Zealand who are from all sorts of ethnic backgrounds. So we're talking about diversity with a bullet. And at Knox, there's more than 30 different nationalities that work there. And that's a lot. And not everybody speaks English as their first language. In fact, English may be their third or fourth language. So Knox has been instrumental in really thinking about how do we enable the community? How do we connect them through language classes that inspire and teach? And the elders have been teaching a lot of the new volunteers English by reading with them. It's that empowerment. And Jill tells me really their volunteer community is principle four in action, the opportunity to give as well as to receive care. And currently they are renovating the kitchen. And if anyone has ever had to renovate a kitchen in a long-term care environment, that is major. So the kitchen's now a big hole and it's being operated out of five containers. You know, the shipping containers, those things that sit on the walls. And one of those containers is the actual preparation space, another one is the storage. And what they've found is that the volunteers are actually filling the gaps of the stuff. You can plan to the nth degree, thinking you know you've got it covered, and the volunteers are seeing that there's a gap, and they are filling that gap, they're being the polyfiller, to actually enable this to happen with a minimum of fuss. And they're being supported by the elders and vice versa. So it's a creative way of doing things, and Knox, for me, just sets the bar of what is possible, and they have an amazing wise leader in their CEO and their team. And I know if you were to go to visit, the first thing you would have would be a greeting by the residents, the resident committee, and you'd have a cup of tea and cake or scones. You guys call it a snack, we call it morning tea. That's what happens. So they are fantastic. So we're going to move on to passion.
Thank you, Sally. How's everybody doing? Great. We're so happy that you're all here and that we have the opportunity to share with you the things that we're doing around the world. We've learned so much from you, and we want to have the opportunity to give back. I represent Western Canada. I think most of you know that Canada is that, you know, expanse to the north of you. And I share the regional coordinator role with my colleague, Sue Ellen Beattie, who's here today. And in Eastern Canada, I think Kathleen and Peter had to leave, and I haven't been able to find them, but they're the regional coordinators for Eastern Canada. And so we're doing that great work of culture change up there as well. 2 years ago, I had the incredible opportunity of announcing to this crowd that at Sherbrooke Community Center in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, that we would be opening our first classroom where a group of grade six students, the nursing home would become their classroom. And I'm here to be able to tell you now that it has been a success story that has exceeded everyone's expectations. I know from the very beginning, when I first heard about the Eden Alternative, there was talk about how wonderful it would be if the nursing home became a part of the school. And so to see this actually come into action is just an incredible thing. Because what better way to lead the culture change movement than to educate our children? Because they are the leaders of the future. And as we watch the passion grow in the relationships between the children and the elders, it is just a most incredible thing. For any of you who are wanting to learn more about this, there is a session today. Carrie Albert, who is our grade six teacher, our amazing grade six teacher, is doing a presentation in one of the breakout sessions right after lunch today. And I really encourage you to go and hear what she has to say. The picture that you see here is one of our elders with a group of the students. The elder is Dr. Jody Grant, and she has her doctorate in education. And she came to live at Sherbrooke a number of years ago after an accident, and pretty much felt like her life was over, and that there was no meaning, no reason to get out of bed in the morning, and she was in a great deal of pain. And this has changed her life. She has become not only a mentor, an elder to the children, but also to Carrie. Carrie talks about how important it is to have that kind of mentorship for her as she is on this journey. And when I put the message out that I wanted to tell a story about our iGen, that's the name of our class, iGen, and it stands for intergenerational schooling. What I received was a poem that was written by the elders. We have the involvement of students everywhere, and one of the students that comes in regularly is from the university, an English student, and they've been doing writing with the children and with the elders, and the children have been writing poems about loneliness and helplessness and boredom. And it's been very insightful to see and to hear the words of the children. But when the children were on their break this year, the elders still got together, and this is the poem that they wrote for the children. And it's called, They See Me. And it's written by a number of our elders, Verna, Kelly, Jody, Dawn, Joe, Donna, and Eileen. And this is their poem. A warm feeling envelops me as I embrace the exuberance of the students of iGen. Their hugs, their smiles, their youthful enthusiasm are all a breath of fresh air. They care enough to know who I am. They see me, the person, and not only the disability. The iGen students make me feel younger. They're not afraid to try something new. They're so responsive to our mentoring and run with the challenges we give them. They see me, the person, and not only the disability. The iGen students make me feel how I want to feel. I feel happy. I feel satisfied. I feel grateful. I feel excited. I feel their youth. I feel accepted. They see me, the person, and not only the disability. The iGen students are our future. We share our knowledge of our past and present, and they carry it forward through their advanced education and technology. I wish I could bottle up their energy and give it to them when they're older. They see me, the person, and not only the disability. Thank you.
I do come from a big country with a small population. It's Iceland, one of the Scandinavian countries. The population are only 330,000, and the family bonds are very close. And when I look back and think about my grandmother, I find myself so blessed. I was able to watch how my grandmother was in charge at the big farm. Many generations lived together at the old Icelandic farm, and everything was homemade. It is about time to seek into the cultural heritage our grandmother left us. The farms were both homes and producer. They provided everything that the family needed to thrive on. The soil was nurtured, and our grandmother grew all kinds of vegetables. The animals provided the family food, as well as material for clothing, like wool. My grandmother's butter was the best, and everything was kept clean and tidy, so there was minimum risk for infection among the people. The children and the elders were taken care of with love and respect. Roles were clear in that everyone participated in taking responsibility and doing their share of work. Everyone was supposed to do their jobs to the best of ability. Children, teenagers, and the elders at the farms were provided with tasks that were suitable for their capability. But it was not all work. The evenings were entertaining. People laughed, played, danced, told stories, read poems, and played music. We should look back and appreciate the way our grandmother were running the farm and household before the industrial revolution. Following the Second World War, with the Industrial Revolution, assembly line work became the main focus, rewarding the utmost productivity. We are, in some aspects, still in that phase with elderly care today. I can see how my mother was influenced by her mother, and I, myself, have involved my grandmother's view and values into the Eden alternative leadership. Grandmother's way illustrates cultural change, how to care for the elderly and children in their homes. And so it will hopefully be for our daughters and granddaughters in the future. This cultural heritage in leadership from my grandmother and your grandmothers is real and genuine and engraved in my way of thinking. it is about time to involve more openly grandmother's wisdom and values into the Eden alternative leadership. To love and respect ourselves and others is the foundation for my grandmother's values, and we should take those values today and cherish them. Unfortunately, not everyone is so blessed to have had such a wonderful grandmother as I did. But if you think about it, I'm sure you know some woman or man that you have met that resembles my grandmother in her views and way of living. My grandmother was unaware that she was a real leader on that big farm with a great success and in her humble way of being. My grandmother said so often, "They are just doing it all by themselves." My grandmother and your grandmother way of leadership are built on ancient wisdom and values. Lao Tse and Chinese philosopher who lived 500 years before Christ says in his book about the way and the power, "When the greatest kings have managed their work to perfection, the people will say, we did it ourselves." And Gandhi said, "The leader is not the leader with the most followers. The leader is the one who create the most leaders." We should let this concrete wisdom and values lead the way in Eden alternative leadership. Thank you.
Thank you. You're still keeping up? Yes. I will catch the words visionary and sustainability and give you an example among a lot of examples we have from Eden, Denmark. We are a small country with about 5 to 6 million people. Correct me?
Yes.
98 municipalities brought together in 5 regions. So that's a very small country. A little bigger than this, but it's there. I'll share with you, you can see the 2 top pictures is one of our leaders called Sina Moltrup, and she is a leader in one of Kit Lysen Petersen's nursing homes in Assen municipality. Her personal leader journey started when she became a nursing home leader in 2008. And she behaved in a very traditional way for nurses. With her own words, she had a huge focus on task solving to ensure the medical and nursing needs, the professional quality via evidence-based knowledge. For example, she was guided by the residence council and said no to have new residents move into the nursing homes with a beloved pet. Several years ago, Eden Denmark met Sina at a meeting where an elderly resident told about the meaning of her nursing home everyday life. She lived together with her dog all day long. He had become her personal friend, not like the dogs visiting with its owners, as it tend to be dominating in Denmark right now, involving professional visitor dogs examined by professional dog trainers. They do not become friends in the same way. Sina suddenly understood what her no meant to the persons with pets moving into their nursing home, and she decided to change her beliefs and attitude. She dared to follow a new vision. During a weekend, she found a suitable dog to adopt into their nursing home, and Basse, that's his name, and I have to tell you the picture where you can see Basse very clearly. It's a selfie. And to make a selfie with Basse, Sina had to lay down on the floor together with the dog. So, yeah. Basse, he became a very special friend to a very lonesome and vulnerable resident. Their friendship became so close that when he later was hospitalized, the dog howled goodbye to him. No one ever heard him do that before. The resident unfortunately died in the hospital, and when he was buried, Sina asked the priest if Basse was welcome in the church during the ceremony. He wasn't. Several of the staff members participated in the funeral, and outside the church, Sina chose to wait with Basse to greet his dear friend a last time. She could not understand why her staff was more sad than usual coming out from the church. "Can't you hear?" they said. And then she heard it. The organist played a Danish folk hymn in which a man asks if one can bring the dog with him into heaven when he dies. In that way, the priest tried to show his understanding for the friendship. So what these very determined, present, person, and relation-centered actions Sina shows so deeply that she has developed into a humanized, caring leader who is an artist knowing when to be human and when to be a nurse. She is visionary. Together with Anna Lauerberg, you see in the last picture, who is smiling to us together with their house clown, Lise, and Kirsten Gosvi, who is with us here in Little Rock and tells about her personal journey after this session, and several other great leaders in Denmark. Sina is now maintaining a sustainable Eden Alternative leadership by being full of this courage, showing and giving all the trust and decision-making to the residents, families, and staff members they can have, as well as she demonstrates in everyday life that things can be done in different ways. They both have become role model leaders. The more people in each community sharing the local vision, the more sustainability the new culture will be. Being a registered Eden Alternative home gives them the possibility to benefit from the acceptance and pride in the municipality of them being registered. They make sure that every new bureaucratic attempt to make more measurements, documentation, and new methods and technology to take into use, they clear out how they can do it without letting go of the joint vision for the everyday life each person have, and to maintain that it still are person and relation-centered. They are very determined to maintain an Eden group with both leaders and staff to share experiences and ideas and support each other in bringing the needed role models. They wish to ensure the continuously needed effort to go on and deepen the culture change journey. And in every one of our national networking days, they participate with representatives from their Eden groups to keep themselves updated with new Eden colleagues and see it as a way to get deeper into their own transformation while making use of the learning circles in every meeting. By sharing and having trust, they are convinced that their successful organizational transformations will keep steady in the everyday life, even though they themselves should have to leave their position for some reason. The care area and municipalities need leaders being aware of the importance of every person in the community, no matter what formal role each one has. Leaders who do not stop telling decision makers about what is needed to fight the three unnecessary plagues, but by having the vision to make life worth living for everyone in the community. Yes.
When I hear those stories, I am a blubbering mess. They touch the heart, and when we were planning this, and certainly Sina's story, it's 6 o'clock in the morning for me in Australia, and I've got the tissue box. And all these stories show what's possible. And Nancy Fox, in her session yesterday, said, you either do or you don't. Our take-home message, you're going to do. Don't is a, you know, it's not an option. No is not in the lexicon. So our take-home message is, the messages are, ageism and the three plagues must be eliminated. There is no excuse for not working on this. You need to find the leader in yourself. And if you're a little bit shy about that, go and partner with someone that inspires you. They will help and guide you. No is not an option. Say yes, then work out how you're going to do it later. And there's lots of people who can help you get to yes. And include the elders in everything you do. You might think it's a fabulous idea, but unless the elders are involved, no matter where they are on the continuum of care, you're not going to get to yes. And you're not going to become an inspired leader. So thank you all for staying, which has been fantastic. It's good. That's a measure of our success. And for listening to us and for enabling us to share our stories with you from around the globe. We have the prettiest stand out there. We're going to be there for the day and a half. Sorry, Signature Healthcare, but, you know, we do. And anybody else. So come and say hello. We want to have homes and organisations from around the globe connect. This is not the only time to connect. Oh, and you'll find us on Facebook, i.e., the Eden Alternative, Denmark, UK and Ireland, Canada, Asia, Iceland. We need your numbers and support, folks. So thank you very much and have a great day.